To see someone in government not tell the truth is certainly nothing new, and to hear White House press secretary spin information certainly isn't new either. But have we now entered a new age of misinformation? Frank Bruni from the New York Times wrote a piece about that today, focusing on Press Secretary Sarah Huckabee Sanders. Her trouble with the truth goes back long before this week, though. Everything you're about to hear in this soundbite is actually not true.
I don't think it's appropriate to lie from the podium or any other place. He said the process has people calling us a joke and calling us a laughing stock.
This is what we're about. Specifically said that he received a phone call from the president of Mexico.
They were actually direct. They were direct conversations, not actual phone calls.
So he lied. He didn't receive.
I wouldn't say it was a lie. That's pretty bold accusation. It's the conversations took place. They just simply didn't take place over a phone call that he had them in person.
And I have heard from a large number of individuals that work at the FBI that said that they're very happy with the president's decision.
The president keeps repeating this claim that we're the highest tax nation.
And that's what we are, the highest tax corporate nation.
That's not what he said. He said we're the highest tax nation in the world.
The highest tax corporate nation, it seems pretty consistent to me. Sorry, we're just going to have to agree to disagree.
Well, joining me is New York Times op-ed columnist Frank Bruni and Scott Jennings, former special assistant to President George W. Bush. Frank, you write that you watched Sarah Sanders' press briefings with what you described as sheer awe. I know you didn't mean it as a compliment. In fact, you say, quote, we've surrendered any expectation of honesty, and that you actually miss Sean Spicer. Can you just explain that?
When I watched Sean Spicer, he would get this panic looked. He would appear to me flustered, like he kind of knew he was a man swimming against the current and he was never going to keep his head above water. Sarah Huckabee Sanders seems utterly at peace with the fictions that she peddles. And I find that disturbing. I also find it disturbing. I don't see her attracting the censor or the ridicule that Sean Spicer did. And I think that's because 9 months into the Trump administration, we are all so accustomed to being lied to. We're so accustomed to seeing, villain portrayed as victim, bad portrayed as good. And that really worries me because I worry, bigger than her, I worry that the Trump administration is lowering our standards for government.
You think this has become normalized?
Absolutely, yeah. And I think it's not normal. Listen, every press secretary, I've been around for a while, as have you, every press secretary that we've watched over the decades has tried to make his or her boss look, as heroic as possible, portray them in the best light. And to that extent, some of what she's doing is just par for the course. But she goes the extra mile.
Scott, I'm wondering what you make of what Frank is saying and the job that Sarah Sanders is doing.
Well, two things. Number one, I think that if what you're wishing for is for a White House press secretary to walk out to the podium and trash their boss or correct their boss or sort of line up with where the press corps is on Donald Trump, that is not going to happen. It's not going to happen in this White House. It's not going to happen in any White House. And number two, I appreciate what Frank says about previous press secretaries, but I think that he's describing Sarah Sanders and Sean Spicer before her as though they have taken it to a level we've never seen, when I remember watching Josh Earnest at the podium lie about the nature of President Ronald Reagan's victories. I remember watching him lie about the $400 million in ransom we paid Iran. And I don't remember anybody showing outrage about the White House press secretary then. So I tend to think people are viewing these press secretaries through the lens of their own personal hatred for the president. And that is rubbing off on how they view the staff.
Frank?
Well, I respectfully disagree. I think if you watch, especially over the last week, and that's why I wrote the column at the end of this week, if you watch Sarah Huckabee Sanders' behavior at the lectern this week, there's a kind of contempt that she and so many other people in the Trump administration show for the media that I think is beyond what we've seen before.
Well, Frank, the moment we heard earlier when Sanders was pressed on the president's assertion that the U.S. is flat out the highest tax nation on earth, in fact, that's not accurate, and she weaved this response, I guess the president's allies would say, look, she's just helping him clarify his remarks.
Well, I mean, she is, but she's also pretending that that's exactly what he said. And there was a moment this week when Jim Acosta said, you know, the president said that our justice system is a joke and a laughingstock. And she got into it with him. She corrected him and she gave him a different version of it that, in fact, was farther from his verbatim words than what Jim Acosta had explained. There's this reflexive, you are all wrong and we are all right.
I think frequently Sarah is in the position of having to explain again and again and again what Donald Trump does so well. He absorbs people's emotions and then he reflects those emotions, particularly of his base, in a lot of his comments. And I think that is frequently mischaracterized as her lying or as her trying to clean things up. But she's explaining what Donald Trump is doing, and it continues to baffle the media that that's what he does very well. And so I think that press secretaries over the years have evolved from public information officers into essentially the chief White House pundit. They are the core reflection of how the occupant of the Oval Office sees the world. And we're holding Sarah and we held Sean to a standard that I'm not sure we held previous press secretaries to. Maybe we should have, and that's a debate we could have. But you use the word contempt. I mean, if she holds you all in contempt, I mean, I would respectfully say that the media, frankly, looks like they hold Donald Trump in contempt, and so the contempt is flowing both ways. I tend to agree ratcheting down the contempt would be better, but this is not a one-way street when it comes to contempt in this briefing room right now.
It's not a one-way street, but to pretend that we can evaluate Sean Spicer and Sarah Huckabee Sanders in the context of all previous press secretaries is to pretend something bigger, which is that Donald Trump is a truly normal president. And would you really say that, Scott?
No, I agree with you. This is not a normal presidency as compared to what we've seen. But I do think what is normal is the White House press secretary essentially being a reflection of how that particular president views the world. Now, how he views the world may be different and abnormal, as you put it, but that doesn't make the press secretary abnormal in what they're doing, which is reflecting how their boss sees things.
When she was asked about the president's ridiculous and, you know, incredibly inappropriate tweet about Mika Brzezinski, she kind of went on this reverie about what a heroic man he was and how he's so tough and strong and that's why Americans love him. It's always a little bit too much and too far. Now, if that's what the president demands, that's what the president demands, but she is under no obligation to continue serving him.
Well, not only is that what the president demands in this case, but what you just described to her is exactly what Donald Trump does. I mean, you would probably argue that he always goes too far, that he takes things too far.
So
again, I go back to this point. The White House press secretary has become a reflection of the thinking of their boss. It was true for Obama's press people, for Bush's, for Clinton's. You know, and it seems to get more pronounced as time goes on, but it is not unique to this White House. Even if this presidency is not normal, it's not unique to this White House.
Well, Frank Bruni, Scott Jennings, appreciate it. Thank you.
This is CNN breaking news.
Today, the president said in the wake of the terror attack in New York that killed eight people, he's calling on Congress to immediately end the diversity immigrant visa program, calling it a, quote, disaster for our country.
This program grants visas not on a basis of merit, but simply because applicants are randomly selected in an annual lottery. And the people put in that lottery are not that country's finest. We know that the program presents significant vulnerabilities to our national security. It's a very unsafe program for our country, and we're not going to allow it to happen.
Back now with the panel, joining the conversation, Peter Beinart and Christine Quinn. I just want to point out, yesterday, Sarah Huckabee Sanders said there was no vetting of the people in this program, which is not actually the case. They're actually vetted as much as anybody else is vetted who comes to this country. You can argue the vetting's not strong enough. You can argue that we shouldn't have this program at all. That's to be discussed, which I'm curious to hear. What do you think of this program?
Well, first of all, let's remember it also was a bipartisan program when it was developed.
But a lot of people have been trying to get rid of it.
Absolutely. But let's just make sure, sure. You know, and I have to say I take umbrage as a New Yorker that it got blamed on Chuck Schumer. Right. So we just need to be about the facts of the evolution. I don't think there's anything wrong with wanting to have a debate, an appropriate policy debate about different programs in immigration. But this isn't that. This is immediately in the wake of a terrorist attack in the city that suffered the worst terrorist attack in history, moving immediately to kind of rock 'em, sock 'em, blame each other politics. A. B, it's drawing conclusions based exclusively on the program that this killer got in through. None of that is helpful, none of that is thoughtful, and none of that, I believe, will really address the problems as it relates to terrorists coming into New York. But what it also really did, and I want to be clear, Democrats can be criticized of this just as much as Republicans. In the wake of a tragedy, the president and other electeds have done it too, didn't take on the job of uniting, didn't take on the job of bringing us together. He took on the mode of splitting us apart. And look, we're New York. We will always take care of ourselves and we will always push on. But that's not right for America. And it clouds this whole conversation, which is an important one.
Brian, what do you think of this program?
Listen, both sides do it all the time, what you're saying, sort of to take advantage of the dynamics to push a public policy. The Democrats are guilty of it. I guess the Republicans are guilty of it. But what is wrong with reviewing our immigration laws that protect Americans?
But nothing's wrong with it. But what's wrong with it is doing it moments after people were plowed down.
Peter, when you hear the president say, you know, the people in this lottery are not the country's best.
Right.
I think actually there's a pretty good argument to get rid of this lottery program. Let's be clear about what Trump's agenda is, right? Donald Trump, first of all, wants to cut immigration in half overall, right? Regardless of how people come in, right? Secondly, he wants fewer Mexicans and he wants fewer Muslims. It's absolutely obvious if you go back to the campaign that that is the agenda. And he should be honest about that, right? If he wants to, the problem with it, yeah, absolutely, because he proposed a Muslim ban, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah, but
and when he talks
Let Peter finish.
The claim about chain migration mm-hmm. is clearly aimed at the fact that we have a large Latino population that is bringing in family members. If you don't think that's a dog whistle to people who watch Breitbart, okay.
Right, I don't.
Brian, respond.
Yeah, listen, it's the whole thing that he was targeting Mexicans I actually find offensive. You know, I myself am from Hispanic descent. I never felt targeted by that.
He attacked Judge Curiel, you didn't feel targeted by that?
That bothered me. That made me very uneasy because that's an American citizen. That actually did make me uneasy. You pointed out something. But the whole, say, blanket statement that he doesn't want Mexicans in here, it's just not accurate.
When you call them rapists?
Criminals.
It's just not accurate, is my point. It's like he even said, we're going to build a wall and we're going to have a nice door that's going to let the people in through a proper vetting process. What is wrong with that system?
Two things. First of all, on the one point that Christine made early about his attack on Chuck Schumer, I thought it was completely untimely and inappropriate. And it's something that he has done over and over again. He attacked the mayor of San Juan right after the hurricane there. He attacked the mayor of London right after the terrorist attack there. That's just not the time to be making political points against a hometown elected official. Now, on the lottery visa, look, I think this country, I think politicians have a right and a responsibility to take a look at what's best for the country. We should have a conversation about a modern immigration system, comprehensive immigration system that meets the requirements of the modern economy in America. We have right now the DREAM Act that's being discussed. There's a deadline for it. We've got this lottery visa program that's being discussed. All of that was part of the Gang of Eight comprehensive immigration proposal a few years ago. It is time to take a comprehensive look at this, come up with a bipartisan proposal and try to address all these issues.
Look, I think everybody here, I think you're missing what's happening. I mean, Americans, that was you're right, that was on the table. Comprehensive amnesty for illegals was on the table. Rejected not only by the Congress, but then by the American people. The president ran, Donald Trump ran on a message. From the time he came down the escalator, he said, and Americans bought into it, we're sick of an immigration system that allows these people to come and kill us. Whatever the system is that's bad or good, however the vetting happened or didn't, we're sick of it. And when he says we're going to change the system, what he's doing is turning up the pressure on politicians have shown that they're spineless and feckless, and the people are sick of it. So the harshness of it, all that, hey, you know what? 8 people are dead because of a system that is broken.
And then we got to go, Christine.
You know, I just find it the vast, greatest example of hypocrisy, that when 8 people are dead, it appears to be killed by a Muslim, we immediately attack that group of people. But when a white man, should we not let people from Florida go to Nevada because of what that man did at Las Vegas? No, it is the same. Because the president picks out people who I am talking. But president picks out people who he believes will easily be hated, that other people will turn against, and he rips us apart. He is a hypocrite. And if he really was going to be straight across the board, we would look at issues in the way Anna said. All he wants to do is engender fear. Right. He doesn't want to find solutions. And what he did, saying nothing about Las Vegas and the man who perpetrated that. What, does Floridians have to stay in Florida?
We got to go. I want to thank everybody for bringing the panel. Molly Ball, Anna Navarro, Ed Martin, Asha Rangappa, Brian Lanza, and Michael Zeldin. Michael, let's just start with you. I mean, there's a lot of moving parts on this. Given your experience with Mueller, what stands out to you today based on all that's happened?
Well, what stands out most is that the President of the United States cannot go under oath, that his disconnected stories over the course of these months that we've been following this create for him the possibility of a perjury trap if he goes under oath. And I think Ty Cobb and John Dowd know this. I think that that's his personal greatest liability.
Can he avoid going under oath at some point?
No, probably not. But they'll try to stretch it out as long as they possibly can so that they know as much as they possibly can so they can create a narrative that hopefully he can stick to as a witness.
Are you saying he can't go under oath because he's not being truthful, or he can't go under oath because he just may not recall, or he doesn't have the ability to recall all of these moving parts?
I think he can't tell the truth. That's what I'm saying. I think that he can't go under oath from a legal jeopardy standpoint because he doesn't tell the truth with respect to what he knows. And that is a problem. And if you're Ty Cobb or John Dowd, you have to make sure that the president is protected. And the way you protect him is to keep him from testifying under oath if possible, or at least have him testify under oath at the very end, so when you know as much as you can about people, what people have said, and that you can create a narrative that you can stick to that's truthful.
Asha, what do you think of that?
Well, I think that the fact that they're getting Kushner's take on what happened with the Comey firing makes it pretty clear that Mueller has an obstruction case on the president, and he intends to build it. Remember, when obstruction is when you take an action which may in itself actually be legal, but you do it for corrupt reasons, okay? You do it for reasons that you know are wrong. And that's difficult to prove. It's hard to get into somebody's mind. Mueller is many things, but he's not a mind reader. So he's gonna go to things that were said and done and written before and after. And this is an administration that has very loose fingers, okay? I mean, we know just from these Russian emails or whatever that they are not careful about what they've been writing.
Seems like loose lips also get
and
all
loose
the leaks.
Lips. I mean, we know that the president himself tweets. The half of the obstruction case has been created by the president himself against himself. So, you know, this tells
me. So Kushner is of interest because not only I mean his entire role in the campaign and financial dealings of his own that may be an issue, but in terms of the Comey firing and also on the flight where they're crafting the letter
That's
for
right.
Donald Trump Jr.
So
he's involved.
Here's where the Russia ties come in. If there are connections between Kushner and Russia and Don Jr. and all of these things, that creates a motive for Trump to want to make this go away. So again, those contacts will help bolster Mueller's case of obstruction against the president, as will any, you know, financial shenanigans that may have been happening in the past. But all of these give a vested interest on the part of the president to want this investigation to go away, which will help Mueller in his obstruction case.
Well, just to follow up on that, to my point that the president is having trouble telling the truth, the Air Force One story that was put forth initially about the June 9th meeting was just not true. Mm-hmm. Right. And if he said that under oath to Mueller, the initial story that I had nothing to do with it, I don't know anything about it, that would be a lie. That would be an actionable false statement for which Papadopoulos tells us you could go to jail for several years. That's the greatest risk for the president.
Ed?
Well, I'm almost stunned to listen to this. I mean, we're speculating about things that didn't happen, might happen. You've got him on perjury charges. You know, today's news is that we have a junior staffer who says in a meeting that he was big timing, trying to say, I'll set up a meeting with Putin. And everybody said, don't bother. I don't know if you have ever, anybody here has been on a campaign, Anna has, when you, especially a big campaign, she's been on bigger ones. There's lots of people in the room trying to big time and say, hey, I'll do this, I'll do that, I've got donors or whatever. So we're taking that and we're going all the way forward to the president.
How do you know he's big time? Because he actually did have contact with
Well, everybody, you can see it. And they've all said that no one did anything with it. The fact that it's not remembered by anybody is an indication that this was a guy who was trying to. I mean, my argument is
seems
as plausible.
Seems like it's remembered by this guy J.D. Gordon, who was sitting there.
Right, but my argument is plausible. Okay, he's another junior staffer, but I mean, the fact that Sessions and Trump don't believe it is as likely as this idea that they sat there and said, oh my goodness, let's go to Russia. Oh no, we won't tell anyone about it. I mean, they don't remember that conversation of some staffer, and now we're all the way back to some kind of convoluted theory of perjury. I've never heard anyone talk about that. The president...
Well, the president does not tell the truth, and under oath has a history of under oath not telling the truth. I mean, in his lawsuit against Tim O'Brien, I mean, he was demonstrably lying, you know, dozens of times.
Well, but whatever it is in the past that we want to point to that says now, therefore, that what's true is a Russia conspiracy, there's no evidence of Russia impacting the election. There's now a kind of a hunt on by Mueller to think that Jared Kushner, I mean, look, at the interview before, I think it was very important, Anderson, on the show with Schwartz, he said Mueller will get him, not on anything to do with Russia. He'll just get him on something from his past, financial. If that's the goal stated by Mueller or anybody else, that's the problem, right? We're in a this is a coup of the American people's election.
Anna?
Well, first of all, Mueller has not stated that, right? So when we're talking about speculation, that is speculation on your part. I have been on big campaigns. I've never seen coffee boys be able to have direct communication with campaign managers or sit around the table with the top executives, the top echelon of the campaign. Look, I think what this tells us is, as we sit here trying to read tea leaves, it's just how thorough, how focused, how concentrated Bob Mueller is. He's not paying attention to the noise around him. He has amassed an impressive entourage, an impressive team of the best prosecutors and investigators in this country. He is peeling away the layers of this onion, and somebody's going to end up crying.
Well, yeah, I mean, as a non-legal expert, right, not a prosecutor, not a lawyer, I have no idea what, if any, case Mueller may be trying to build. But from the standpoint of a political observer and a Trump observer, it's very clear that some of Trump's most sensitive areas are under the microscope right now. And that's part of what a prosecutor does, is put pressure on areas that he knows are sensitive, right? So the fact that he's looking into old financial dealings, things from long before the campaign, and the White House will tell you, look, all of this stuff that Manafort and Gates are being indicted for is way before they ever took up with Trump. That's true. But what Trump may be hearing from that is they're looking at old tax returns.
But it was also allegedly going on during the campaign. I mean, there were efforts to, you know, there was outreach to Russian oligarchs about briefings on the campaign and things like that.
But the activity in the indictment, for the most part, the stuff that they're looking at with the activities in Ukraine had nothing to do with the Trump campaign itself.
Molly, for the part about the Republican convention that Manafort managed, where the Republican platform, specifically on Ukraine, was changed to, you know, benefit the benefactors of Paul Manafort. So there's a connection there.
We got to take a quick break. We're going to have more with the panel. I want to get Ryan in on this as well. The president made the newest remarks to a radio station tonight. We'll play you those. And later, new remarks from the president on immigrants after this week's attack here and the controversy they may be causing ahead. We'll talk about that. He lamented his limited options.
The saddest thing is that because I'm the President of the United States, I am not supposed to be involved with the Justice Department. I'm not supposed to be involved with the FBI. I'm not supposed to be doing the kind of things that I would love to be doing. And I'm very frustrated by it.
Back now with the panel. Brian, we didn't get to hear from you. What do you make of I mean, all the day's developments today?
I guess there's three. We'll go one by one. You know, the Jared, what we learned about Jared is that he is fully cooperating. He volunteered the information, same information he's volunteered to all the congressional committees looking into this Russia stuff. He's been transparent. And I think that's what you want. That's not certainly somebody who's hiding anything. That's somebody who is focused on the president's agenda.
Although a number of his declaration forms did have to be amended numerous times.
Sure. And others will be amended as they go forward with other people. I mean, the fact is he amended them. He didn't say no. He didn't stick to whatever was there. He clearly acknowledged that a mistake was made, and he amended them. He didn't say anything different than that. And I think that's what we have to look at as for, you know, whether the president should go on, you know, whether he should be put, you know, through ask questions by the investigator. I think the president knows what the stakes are, and I think he's going to answer all those questions honestly. I think, as somebody who worked on the campaign, there was, you know, I sort of sit here it's rather obnoxious to hear everybody talk about this Russia collusion when you know the facts just don't bear out. when we know the fact that there's only one campaign that hired a foreign national that coordinated with the Russians to get involved in this campaign, and that was the Clinton campaign. You can't deny those facts. Now, you have Papadopoulos.
But were you involved with Cambridge Analytica and their conversation? So you don't know what went on there.
You're right. I don't know what went on there. But right. we do know.
And on Air Force One, when they wrote that letter,
hired a foreign national
Air Force One,
to coordinate with the Russians.
Right.
That's what we do know. So
but on Air Force One, you were not on Air Force One when that conversation about coming up with a reason for Donald Trump Jr. So
right. I'm not
there's a lot going on.
Neither was anybody.
But I'm talking about my campaign experience, and I'm talking about the facts that exist right now.
Right.
And so the facts the facts are what they are. You know, you have a lot of sort of conjecture of what the Trump campaign did or what the Trump campaign didn't. You have a vendor who reached out to Assange who we didn't know anything about it, reached out and Assange sort of turned them down. But when you look at compared to what else exists, is we have one campaign.
But were you aware during the campaign that Papadopoulos had had this conversation with the Russian professor and had been in contact with Paul Manafort about it?
No.
Okay, so there was stuff going on in the campaign.
Absolutely.
That other people would not be aware.
Yes, but let's look at what the facts are. We know that Papadopoulos, you know, George Papadopoulos, you know, he's now a convicted felon. He's a convicted liar. He lied to the FBI. It's not like nobody knows not to lie to the FBI. There's been enough information out there that this investigation is going on that everybody's going to say the way that Mueller's going to get you is by lying to the FBI, and he still chose to lie.
See, that's,
so you
got
to go to judgment.
Why would George Papadopoulos lie to the FBI? I mean, Michael, you've worked with Mueller. Why?
You know,
I mean, anybody's watched a cop show and knows that, you know.
Well,
I haven't been watching Matlock.
I think that he thought. I'm reading into his mind, which I'm not very good at, but I think that he thought that he could either, one, get away with it, or two, thought that he was protective of the institution that he worked for and may want to work for, because it makes no sense objectively. Why would you lie when the FBI asks you a question? So he had to have some rationale for it. And usually, I think, it's because they think they'll get away with it.
It might have been because he thought he was a small fish. You know, in this big pond where there's so many people with much bigger names and much bigger roles that are being taken a look at. Now, one of the interesting aspects about the Jared Kushner angle is that they can't deny Jared Kushner, right? They deny practically everybody else. Papadopoulos, because, you know, his name just rolls off the tongue. Oh, no, we don't know who he is. He was a coffee boy. Manafort, oh, he was, you know, he had a minor role. He was just around for a few months. Rick, who's that one? Rick who?
Sure.
With Jared Kushner. You can't deny Jared Kushner.
Can I make a comment on what we heard the president say in that interview?
Yeah.
I think it's very important. I think it's a kind of a setup for what we may see. I know Schwartz said it. We're coming towards a crisis, I suspect, at least a crisis of understanding. If the president of the United States is not in charge of the Justice Department, if he's not in charge of the Attorney General, if he's not in charge of that, then no one is. And we're going to have J. Edgar Hoover on steroids going forward. And
but
my
wait,
point
do
is...
Do you want the president of the United States
I want the president...
thwart the course of justice?
No, it's not the course of justice. I want him to be the president of the executive branch. It's a little bit like today when we're going to the next subject.
So you don't want the FBI to be independent or
they're
the
not independent.
Department.
They're not independent. That's
Ed,
not designed that
you
way.
Know, Ed, I think Other you country. Can get a great... You might be able to get exile in Cuba, maybe Venezuela, even the Philippines, if you want that kind of dictatorship.
That's
you
not
want
a dictatorship.
That's
exactly the opposite.
Of course it is. If
no,
you,
it's exactly
if, with
the opposite.
What you're saying, you want the president of the United States to be in charge of the FBI in terms of getting involved with
That's
investigations
the Constitution.
And DOJ.
I want the Constitution.
Well, I will tell you that it's very scary, particularly when you have a president that goes on vendettas
well,
and that has
wait,
a tantrum.
Wait,
that
I, Anderson,
does.
Very quickly. The IRS, there was a big question the IRS targeted right. people when Obama was in that were in conservative groups. That was shown to be somewhat true, right? That is
mostly.
Obama's. That's yeah. Obama. Somewhat true.
Mostly
I mean,
false.
But,
yeah.
but I mean, okay, so one infringement on people's rights is okay with you, but not mostly
no,
true.
No,
but
no,
let me finish. Let me finish.
Then let
either,
me respond.
Okay, but either we have a constitution that allows an election to be meaningful, or we have a country run by bureaucrats. We have a country run by the deep state. I don't think we do. I think we have a...
So anybody, I mean, so you want any administration that comes in to be able to determine who should get investigated, who you don't want there to be a permanent... class
no,
of professionals
what,
who work for the FBI,
no,
who work for the
not,
Department of Justice.
No, wait, ultimately, you know, when the FBI does something wrong and when the Justice Department does something wrong, you know, who's responsible for that? Who is accountable for that? I mean, these are appointed officials.
Right.
So you go to
they,
the elected
right.
official
so,
who's accounted for that.
Well, okay,
so
Mike,
may,
that's the
may,
process.
You used
that's
to work.
Our Constitution.
Right. So the president is in charge of the executive branch. And with respect to policy, he sets policy for the Justice Department and for the FBI. That's with
not,
respect.
That's not the Constitution.
Yes, that's
no,
the.
It's that, not. Yeah.
Okay, well, let him finish. Let him finish.
That is the manner in which, by policy for 50 years, the president interfaces with the Bureau and with the Justice Department and all other branches of the executive with respect to defining the policy of the executive branch. What he cannot do by policy is interfere with specific criminal cases. And what the president's MAL interview seemed to lament was that he couldn't do that. No one prevents him from running the executive branch as a policy matter. But policy